I'm Richard Aitken. I'm one of the lawyers at Aitken Robertson. We're a criminal law firm that does DUI law in Oshawa and indeed throughout most of Southern Ontario. I'm here with Richard Robertson. Richard is our student at law, soon to become a lawyer, and he'll be helping us explain how the instrument works. In fact, Richard will also do a test. So, how does it work?
The Intoxilyzer brand of breath testing apparatus is a series of breath testing machines. Currently in Canada, we're using the 8000C model, but we do see the 5000 available in some jurisdictions, and we anticipate the 9000 to become available in the future. Is a machine that gauges the blood alcohol content of one's breath using infrared spectrometry. How this works is that a sample is submitted into the device, and then the elements of that sample, and what I mean by the elements, the actual atoms of that sample are analyzed using infrared spectrometry. And what I mean by that is that infrared light is passed through the sample in order to determine the amount of ethanol which is contained within that sample. Ethanol reacts differently to the infrared light compared to the other molecules, principally oxygen, in your breath. Therefore, as your sample passes through this machine, and it engages with the infrared light, which is being transmitted through your sample, what ends up happening is that the ethanol gets trapped while the oxygen is enabled to pass through. As a result of that, we know how much standard oxygen there should be in a sample, and therefore the amount of ethanol that is absorbed, and it gives us a reading of how much ethanol or alcohol was actively in your breath sample at that time, and we're able to gauge the overall breath alcohol content, or BAC. And that's what we're testing this with this machine. This is different from other machines which use a fuel cell to test. This is considered the infrared spectrometry to be the most thorough form of breath testing available, and this is why we see these machines being deployed and used in our police stations throughout the country.
All right, Jared, I understand you had a beer?
I did. I consumed a beer about 15 to 20 minutes ago.
All right, so I assume it's a standard beer, so likely 5% alcohol by volume and roughly 12 ounces.
I would say that was correct.
All right, so let's start the sample. There'll be a start button at the front there. If you press that,
I'm going to engage the machine. And it's coming off of standby mode, and in about 55 seconds, it will be able to take a sample.
All right, we know from the hum that the instrument is ready to accept the sample. So in terms of the instructions, Chert, if we were at a police department, the officer would be telling you to do a long, continuous blow and have all the deep lung air emptied from your system.
Yes, that is the goal of taking the test, is that the sample that you're providing into the instrumentation is a sample which contains deep lung air. You want to get the most genuine test results possible for your BAC, and you don't want the test to be implicated by residual mouth alcohol or any leftover breath, should we say, in the oral cavity. So when providing a sample, the test taker is encouraged to provide a deep lung air, and what the Intoxilyzer machine is designed to do is that when you're providing a sufficient sample of air into the machine will give you a tone. So what we're going to look for here as I provide this sample is a consistent tone which indicates that sufficient deep lung air is being provided into the machine. So without further ado, I will provide a sample into our Intoxilyzer.
All right, you'll see there, Chert did a long, continuous breath, deep lung air. If this was actually at a police station, the officer would be saying, blow harder, blow harder, blow harder. The machine wants at least 5 seconds of air. The police typically want at least 10. And keep in mind, the deeper the lung air, the higher the result. So the police typically want the higher results. They want to be able to make out their charge. It looks like the instrument's now analyzing a sample. My guess is probably going to show Chert that maybe 20 or 25 milligrams is my guess, based on your weight, Chert?
I'm pretty light these days. I weigh about 161 pounds. I'm actually going to say that I'm probably going to be a bit higher, closer to the 40 milligram mark.
All right. The result is what?
I was at the 20 milligram mark. Mr. Aitken's learned experience takes the day.
All right, and we'll explain that. Typically, let's say you're perhaps my size, or for the first few hours. In other words, every beer you have, 12 ounce, 5%, is gonna put 35 into your system. Typically, you burn off about half of that an hour. So 35 minus 17, for example, leaves you with 18. Every hour, you're gaining 18. So if you have one can of beer, every hour, you weigh 150 pounds, you're gaining 18. At 4 hours, you're at 72. You're awfully close to 80. If you go to 5 hours, you're now over 80. So people need to know that the urban myth or the rule of thumb that you can only have one beer an hour and be safe, that it works only for the first few hours, and does not work very well for women because typically a higher fat content given curves women have and lighter weight, generally speaking. Perhaps if a woman has any more than one drink, if she were to weigh 100 to 110 pounds, even that would be putting her awfully close to the 50 to 80 range where it might present a problem of a license suspension. So what I'm saying is that when people golf or play hockey, instead of having a beer an hour, they should maybe have light beers, or perhaps have a beer the first hour and a Diet Coke the second hour and do it that way, and very much avoid the last drink. If so many of my clients avoid the last drink, they wouldn't be showing up at my office at 100 milligrams, they'd be at 65 or 70 or 75 and not charged. That's how the science really works.